Thank you very much, Clinton. Good afternoon, everybody. I would like to give you an overview or a presentation on one of the first research areas that we have created here at the Energy Center at the CSR, which looks at energy system analysis and energy system modeling. And one of the first publications that we came out with earlier this year was the costs and benefits of the first renewables that came into the South African power system in 2014. And we basically want, that is something that is ongoing. We will update that study on an ongoing basis. And we will basically be doing outside-in analysis on the effect of renewables that they have on the power system. Now, a little bit of background. The South African power system, we saw that in earlier presentations, is under severe constraints at the moment. We have power generators that are actually meant to be or designed to be the safety net for the system. Gas turbines that are fired with diesel, they are running in the first half of 2014, they ran at roughly 30 or more than 30% average load factor. They are designed for 3 to 4%, so that is a good quantitative indication for the constraintness of the system. And we had load shedding, which means the plant taking off of customer load from the system during 82 days in the first 6 months of 2015, so almost every second day. At the same time, the Department of Energy runs a procurement program, and Clinton is in the IPP office as an integral part of that, to bring new capacity onto the system. 8.1 gig, most of these new capacity as we stand today comes from renewables. 8.1 gigawatt of renewables are earmarked for procurement. Of that, roughly 2 gigawatt, 1.8 gigawatts are already operational as we speak right now. So what we did now is we said, well, now we have the first capacities in the system. We don't need to rely on simulated data anymore. Now we have actual data. Now let us understand what the effect of these first 1.8 gigawatts that are on the system is on the fuel savings of avoiding coal and diesel burn, and on the security of supply situation, meaning avoiding load shedding because the renewables are in the system. We developed a methodology for that, to quantify that, and that's what I want to present to you. First, before we start with the methodology, some actuals about the South African power system in 2015, just so that you know what type of animal it actually is that we are talking about. Well, a power system generally over the longer term is classified through its size in terms of terawatt hours that you produce slash consume. So in the South African power system in the first half of 2015, we generated 114 terawatt hours of electricity in the first 6 months. Over the year, that makes roughly 230 terawatt hours. To put it into perspective, the German power system that we saw earlier this morning by Professor Hoffmann has roughly 600 terawatt hours a year. So it's roughly 40% the size of the German system. What you see on this slide is how these 114 terawatt hours break down into the different supply categories. And you see that the South African power system is a very coal-intensive power system. Almost 100 terawatt hours of these 114, the first 6 months, were produced from coal. We have a little bit of nuclear in the system as well, roughly 5%. The only nuclear power station on the African continent is responsible for that. We have some IPPs that are not wind and solar PV IPPs. We have hydro, we have pump storage contributing on the supply side to these terawatt hours. And then we have something, the gas turbines, the diesel-fired gas turbines, providing 3.3 terawatt hours in the first 6 months. Now, these 3.3 terawatt hours, as I said earlier, should actually be something like 0.3 terawatt hours if the system was unconstrained, which it wasn't in the first 6 months. And then we have something new, which wasn't there 2 years ago. We have roughly 1 terawatt hour coming from wind, and another terawatt hour, a little bit more, coming from solar PV. So renewables in the South African power system, as we speak today, already stand for 2% of the entire electricity production. Now that 2% might sound small, but you have to look at how difficult it is to change an energy system. Energy systems have very, very long lifetimes. We are talking decades up to centuries. And we have managed to introduce 2% of our entire electricity demand within 1 year. That is a very steep ramp up. And I can tell you that if we compare the 1% coming from solar PV, if we compare that to the United States, we have in the last year already surpassed the United States. the United States share of solar PV in the entire American electricity system is 0.5%. Now we stand at 1%. Within 1 year, we have achieved that on the wind side similarly. So don't be misled by the 2%. It's 2% achieved within a year. Yeah. That's on the supply side. Now on the how do we call that? The should have been supplied side. On the load shedding side, we did some analysis also on the load shedding, when that actually happened, on which days and in which hours. The way you have to read that chart is that you see from the, I'm not speaking into this one, right? So I can be more freely. Okay, perfect. So you see, the way you have to read this is we're looking here at the first 6 months of this year, 2015. This is all actual data. And from top to bottom, we have ranked the 31 or 28, depending on which month, days of the months. From left to right, it's from midnight to midnight. And you see, basically, you see all hours in these first 6 months. All the green hours are hours where the system runs normally and customer load is supplied. Orange means stage one load shedding. Stage one relates to 1,000 megawatts being taken off from customer load. Stage two, 2,000 megawatts. Stage three, 3,000 megawatts. So you can see that January was fine, but then February kicked in. March was more or less fine again. April, May, and specifically June, these 3 months were quite difficult. And we had, almost on average, almost every second day load shedding. And in many cases, we had stage two load shedding, which means 2,000 megawatts had to be curtailed from customers. That's quite a significant percentage from the customer load. So that's about the status of the system in 2015. Now about the methodology that we have defined. We basically said, well, we now have these 2 gigawatts of wind and PV in the system, and they as we've heard this morning, solar PV and wind are intermittent. They are dispatched by the weather. They are not dispatched by the system operator. And that's what differentiates them from any other power generator. So we said, well, let's define a methodology on an hourly basis to quantify what actually happened in that hour. And it's an outside-in analysis. We didn't run any detailed system operations model. So we are not. There are many, many other effects that the system operator has to deal with that go beyond this here. But we believe that the methodology that we have defined is a conservative one, meaning that we underestimate the value that the renewables have created. And we basically separate the effect that renewables can have in any given hour of the year into 3 different categories. The first one is, if the system in that hour is unconstrained, and you have your wind and your solar PV providing energy, if you take that wind and PV, like hypothetically, you take that away in that hour, the coal fleet ramps up, and therefore you've effectively saved coal burn in that hour. That's if the system is unconstrained. If the system is constrained, if the gas turbines are running, that's how we measure constraintness, then our logic is that that wind and that solar energy in that hour, if you take that away, then the diesel turbines have to ramp up. The logic being that the coal fleet is already at its limit, otherwise the diesel turbines wouldn't run in the first place in that hour. And then the third effect is that if the diesel turbines run, and the reserves, the remaining reserves of the diesel turbines and of the pumped storage scheme, which are the 2 flexibility means in the system, if the remaining reserves are smaller than the actual wind and solar supply in that hour, then wind and solar have actually, have in fact avoided so-called unserved energy, which is the curtailment of customer load. Now, to illustrate that that principle methodology on 3 specific days, you see what you see here is now actual hourly supply data from the South African power system from the 2nd of January this year. So you see how the nuclear fleet is running as a base supplier. Then we have imports, Kahora Basa is that mostly, and others. We have the hydro and pump storage scheme being the flexibility source. Then you have the coal fleet running more or less constant throughout the day and following the load. And then you have on that day, that was an unconstrained day, and you can see that the by the fact that the diesel turbines, which is this little piece of energy here, they only kicked in the evening hours. And that's actually how they are what they are designed for, so that is a more or less unconstrained day. And now you see this thin blue band of wind supply throughout the day, more or less thick because wind is fluctuating, and then you see the solar PV supply, the yellowish part here on the top. That makes the 1% and the 1% of the total energy supply. Now, our methodology now says on such a day, during these hours here in the evening and during these hours in the day, the system, we, from an outside-in perspective, we say the system was unconstrained, and therefore, if you take wind and PV away, the coal fleet ramps up, hence, we have saved coal in that hour. Now, on a more constrained day, the 9th of April this year, again, hourly data, you can see that this day was more constrained by the fact that the diesel turbines are now running from morning until evening. So here the logic is, this wind energy that is providing during the night is still category A, because the coal fleet would be able to ramp up if you take the wind away. But during the day, if you take this wind and this PV energy away, the diesel turbines have to run harder. So we have saved diesel in these hours. The third category is, on this day, it was 9th of January this year. Here you see that between 8 and 11 o'clock in the morning, both the diesel turbines and the pumped storage is running at its maximum nominal capacity. If in these 3 hours, if the solar PV fleet, which produced between 500 to 800 megawatts, if it had it not been there, then someone on the customer side, on the load side, would have had to be curtailed, because all the supply options are running at their maximum output. So that is the methodology that we have developed, and now we basically took that methodology and applied it for every single hour of the first 6 months of 2015 in order to determine how much coal have we saved, how much diesel have we saved, how much unserved energy, customer curtailment, have we avoided. This is the result in this table from wind and from solar PV, broken down into the three categories. You see the total 2 terawatt hours of energy production, and that's how it breaks down. The 2 terawatt hours avoided roughly 0.5 terawatt hour of producing electricity from coal, 1.5 terawatt hours approximately electricity produced from diesel, and we even avoided 52 gigawatt hours of unserved energy, customer curtailment. These are now actual results for the first 6 months of this year. Now, it's interesting to see that, but it's all gigawatt hours and terawatt hours. It's a bit meaningless if we don't put a price tag to it. So now we've taken for coal, we've taken the actual prices, the average prices from the ESCOM financial report. The same for diesel, we got that from the financial report as well. Unserved energy was determined in many macroeconomic studies, what that actually means to the economy if we cannot serve customer load, and we took the numbers out of the integrated resource plan for that. Now, if you apply these numbers, the cost of coal, diesel, and the value of avoiding customer curtailment, if you put all that together, then in the first 6 months this year, wind and PV together have saved ESCOM 3.6 billion rand of fuel spending that would have had to been spent if the renewables had not been there. In addition to that, renewables avoided during 200 hours in the first 6 months, they avoided customer curtailment, which has a macroeconomic value of additional 4.6 billion rand. That's a value not to ESCOM in isolation, but to the economy as a whole. That makes a total financial benefit of 8.3 billion. Now, you have to counter that. Obviously, wind and PV doesn't come for free. We have to make tariff payments to the independent power producers per kilowatt hour that they generate. These amounted to 4.3 billion in the first 6 months. Subtract this from the 8.3, that leaves us with a net benefit of 4 billion rand in 6 months of this year, roughly 300 million US dollar. Now, that is quite remarkable. If you look at wind specifically, you can see that wind, because wind is already at a lower cost pass, so wind is already the cheaper source than PV at the moment still. So if you sum up the wind numbers, you see that ESCOM actually made money with the wind turbines, from independent power producers. Because ESCOM saved 1.5 billion rand, this is cash savings in ESCOM's account, and it had to pay 1.2 billion to the wind independent power producers. So there was a 300 million rand net cash benefit to ESCOM from wind. Now, what are the next steps? This is now based. The nice thing about these kind of studies is they are in hindsight, which means they are based on actual data. As long as we all agree on the methodology, which is very easy to understand, kind of it's a conservatively defined methodology. If you agree to that, then you apply the numbers, and then these are the numbers. It's not a forecast, but obviously we have to look into the future as well. The next steps are something that we heard this morning already about the load duration curve, and we wanted to look at that as well. What effect have the renewables, the solar and the wind, already today on the load shape of the load duration curve in the South African power system? Can we measure that already? And the answer is yes, we can. So what you see here is the system load. This is the actual system load from August 2014 until July 2015. So it covers an entire year. So you have 8,760 hours in that year, and that's how the load was structured. So we had our peak demand at roughly 35 gigawatts. We have our base load demand at 20 gigawatts, so that was the minimum demand. And now we have defined three different categories, and that's something that we can discuss. Where do you make the cutoff points? But we said anything below, any load that is there for less than 1,000 hours in a year, we consider to be peak load. Anything that is there for more than 6,000 hours a year, we consider to be base load, and everything in between, the green area, we consider as mid-merit load. If you apply these categorizations, the structure in the last year of the South African demand was such that these 35 gigawatts of maximum demand broke down into 25.8 base demand, 5 gigawatt mid-merit demand, and 3.8 gigawatt peak demand. That's, again, actuals. Yeah? Now, what happens now if we calculate the residual load? Residual load is now in the time domain, in the time series. We subtract from the system load the solar PV and the wind supply hour by hour, and then we rank again, and then what we get then is this residual load, which is now the solid curve. So what you see is that the difference between the dotted curve and the solid curve, This area is basically the 3.8 terawatt hours of electricity that were supplied from wind and solar PV in that year. Now, what you see is that the residual load is obviously lower than the system load, clearly, because there's part of a power generator subtracted from it, but you also see that it changes the shape. And even with the 2 gigawatts of wind and solar that we have in the system, only 2% of energy supply, you can already see that effect. And you can even quantify it. Because if you now apply exactly the same cutoff points, 1,000 hours and 6,000 hours a year, you can see that based on the system load, we have this structure. Based on the residual load, we have this structure. So the residual load is by 400 megawatts less base load heavy than the original system load. And that speaks exactly to what Professor Hoffmann said this morning, that the more fluctuating renewables, solar PV and wind, you introduce into the system, the more the demand for base load will go down. And the effect is so strong that even with 2% penetration, we can already see and measure it in the South African system today. Now, that is something now you can say, well, what do I care if base load demand is reduced or not? Well, there's a financial implication to that, because it just happens to be that to build a base load power generator, or base supply power generator better, like such as a coal-fired power station, is substantially more expensive than to build a peaking power generator, such as a gas turbine, or a mid-merit power generator. Not to run it, but just to build it. So just the capital that you have to spend. And if we look at these differentials that were created because of the introduction of renewables, 400 more peak demand, mid-merit more or less the same, 400 megawatt less base demand. If you now multiply that with assumed costs of building new power generators, peaking roughly 8,000 rand for every kilowatt that you install, but baseload coal roughly 25,000 rand for every kilowatt that you install. If you multiply this here with this, sum it all up, then you see that the 2% renewables that we've introduced save us, in addition to the fuel savings, 9 billion in capex that we don't have to spend on expensive baseload generators. And that's an additional effect that has a much more long-reaching effect than the fuel saving, which is only fuel saving of the existing fleet and doesn't consider that we also have to plan into the future. Now, the last aspect is the cost of renewables. You saw that the renewables generated net benefit in the system despite the fact that the projects that we looked at in our study are actually these projects from the first bid window of the Department of Energy and the second bid window from PV. So it's this set of projects that are already online, and these projects are by far the most expensive ones that we will ever have in the system. Because you see, what you see here are the results of the first four bid windows of the Department of Energy's procurement program for renewables. And obviously, it started in 2011, so naturally, whatever we procured here is the first stuff that comes online, and what we procured last year is not online yet. But you see that all a new solar and a new wind project is substantially cheaper than the projects that are already online. And that obviously is not even considered in our study. We are just looking at actuals. What is the amount of money that we actually have to pay? If you take these 80 cents for solar PV, 65 cents for wind, this is what the latest procurement window said. If you now compare that to alternative cost of new builds, then you can see that solar PV and wind on the left-hand side, renewables on the left-hand side, are already today, as we speak, without any further cost reductions on technologies, the cheapest new build options on a pure per kilowatt hour basis consideration, which is not 100% fair to compare it this way because they are dispatched by the weather, which we don't really like. It would be better if we could dispatch them. And all the other stuff is dispatched by the system operator. However, this picture would have been 5 times more expensive just 10 years ago and completely unthinkable that something like solar PV and wind can actually be a substantial part of the electricity system. And now we are in the same ballpark compared to any alternative new build option that we have. And that is quite remarkable. It's only a few countries in the world that have achieved this new build cost parity already. And South Africa is one of them because we have excellent solar resources. We all know that. But we also have excellent wind resources, which the Wasa project has contributed a lot to, that we actually know and understand that. With that, I thank you very much.